One thing chemists want to know is whether or not a particular reaction can happen, whether it is feasible, without going to all the bother and expense of actually trying the reaction out. A reaction is said to be feasible if it can happen according to the thermodynamics. Bear in mind this tells us nothing about the rate at which a reaction may happen. For many redox reactions, we can use the potential difference, also known as voltage, of an electrochemical cell to find out which reactions are thermodynamically feasible. I'm about to start my experiment, so don't forget to put your safety goggles on. In the reaction between zinc metal and copper 2 sulfate solution, the zinc metal transfers electrons to the copper 2 plus ions. If the zinc metal transfers electrons to the copper 2 plus ions directly, the energy available to do work, the free energy, is released as heat. Let's look at that reaction more closely. As we can see, our copper 2 plus ions have been reduced to form solid copper metal on the surface of the zinc. The zinc metal has been oxidized to form zinc 2 plus ions. If we force the electrons through an external circuit to get from the zinc metal to the copper ions, we can use the change in free energy to do work. In the electrochemical cell I'm about to set up here, we have zinc in zinc sulfate solution connected to copper in copper sulfate solution via a salt bridge. The salt bridge contains ions in solution that are free to move. Oxidation occurs at the zinc half cell, making it the negative electrode. Reduction occurs at the copper half cell, causing it to be the positive electrode. Ions flow from the salt bridge to keep the charge of the solution neutral. Here, I am using a voltmeter to measure the potential to do work. Those potentials can be used to predict which reactions are feasible and which are not. The feasible reaction is the one where oxidation occurs at the negative half cell and reduction at the positive half cell. Now we have seen one electrochemical cell, we are going to look at multiple cells. Compared to the large scale apparatus we just saw, this microscale equipment is easy to set up and only uses small volumes of solution. To start with, I'm going to cut a flower petal shape out of my filter paper. As you can see, I have laid our filter paper into a petri dish. I'm now going to add our four metals to the different petals of the flower. As you can see, I've also labelled the petals using pencil. I'm now going to add a few drops of 1 mole per decimeter cube solutions containing those metal ions onto the filter paper underneath the piece of metal. I'm using sulfate solutions here. The metal in contact with the solution containing its ions forms a half cell. To connect these half cells with a salt bridge, we simply add a few drops of a saturated solution of potassium nitrate to the centre of the filter paper. We need to add enough so that it soaks out and meets the other damp areas of the metal solutions. The salt bridge now connects the half cells in the electrical sense, because ions can flow from and into the salt bridge. Now we can start to measure the potential difference of our four different half cells using a voltmeter. If your voltmeter requires setting, we need to set it to the values we are expecting to measure. In this experiment, it's up to about 2 volts, so this is the most appropriate setting. A voltmeter has a positive terminal and a negative terminal. Here, the positive terminal is connected to a red lead and the negative terminal is connected to a black lead. I'll start with our familiar zinc and copper. I touch the lead connected to the positive terminal of the voltmeter to the piece of copper and the lead connected to the negative terminal of the voltmeter to the zinc. Make a note of the potential difference. The same thing is happening here as with the cell I showed you in the introduction, just on a smaller scale. Notice the direction of electron flow. Electrons will leave the negative electrode. Here, the zinc atoms are becoming ions. They are being oxidized. The copper half cell is more positive than the zinc, so electrons flow into the copper half cell. Copper ions are reduced. Ions flow from the salt bridge to keep the charge of the solution neutral. Look what happens to the reading on the voltmeter if we swap over the leads. The zinc half cell is more negative than the copper because zinc is more readily oxidized to its ions, so the zinc metal is losing electrons. The copper is gaining them. Now we can set about measuring the other combinations of half cells. First, zinc and magnesium. If we get a negative reading, we simply swap over the connections to get the positive value. We Record the potential difference and which metal was connected to the negative terminal and which to the positive terminal to give a positive value. Next, iron and magnesium. And now, copper and iron. We measure the potential difference between the copper and zinc to be 0.96 volts. The potential difference between copper and iron is 0.50 volts. Think about the reactivity series. Which metal, iron or zinc, is higher in the series? With this in mind, can you predict what the potential difference between iron and zinc will be? Now, let's see if you were right. Let's measure the iron and zinc cell. Lastly, we measure the magnesium-copper combination. In chemistry, we represent cells using a kind of shorthand, called a cell diagram, which despite its name, is not actually a diagram. We put the more negative half cell on the left, which in the case of the zinc-copper cell, is the zinc half cell. Remember, the negative half cell is where oxidation is occurring, so we put the components in order of increasing oxidation state. The oxidation state of zinc metal is zero, whereas zinc ions are in the +2 oxidation state. Because they are in different phases from each other, zinc metal being solid and zinc ions in solution, we put a single solid line between the two, called a phase boundary. We represent the salt bridge using two vertical lines. The copper half cell is the positive one, so because reduction is occurring, we need to put the components in order of decrease in oxidation state. Again, we add a phase boundary between the solid copper and the copper ions. Keep in mind the flow of electrons when building cell diagrams to help you build them correctly. Now we have the full cell diagram, we can use this to explore the relationship between the other cells we have tested in this video, for example, iron-copper. Use the additional resources attached to this video to practice creating cell diagrams for those other reactions. In a further experiment, we can investigate how the concentration of solution affects the potential difference of a half cell. Again, I have cut a piece of filter paper to form four petals, this time with a piece of copper in each section. And this time I am going to add copper sulfate solutions of different concentrations. To two petals, I have added 1 mole per decimeter cubed copper sulfate solution. To another petal, I have added 0.1 mole per decimeter cubed copper sulfate solution. And to our final petal, I am adding 0.01 mole per decimeter cubed copper sulfate solution. Just like before, I am connecting the petals with a salt bridge of potassium nitrate. Two of the concentrations are the same, 1 mole per decimeter cubed. What will the potential difference be between these two half cells? As we can see here, our potential difference is 0.00 volts. What do you think will happen if I try two different concentrations? I'm now going to try 1 mole per decimeter cubed and 0.1 mole per decimeter cubed. As you can see, our potential difference has changed. I will now try all the other possible combinations of half cells. Now we have seen that concentration of solutions is one condition that can affect the potential difference of a half cell. Can you think of any other variables that can affect the potential difference of a half cell? How might you investigate them? In this experiment, we have seen how we can measure cell potentials and how these relate to the relative reactivity or reducing power of some metals. We have seen the significance of which half cell is negative and which is positive. Hopefully this has got you thinking about how we can use these to predict reactions and how changing conditions might affect them. There is more practice in all of this in the additional resources. Thank you for watching and have fun with your experiments.
Inspiring your teaching and learning.